a sphere of phenomenon that was just, in some sense, a condition of suffering. I mean, you could have said you were being mindful of dukkha in that situation, but you were having a very frustrated time as a yogi
Because I
looking.
wasn't being mindful.
Okay, so there's two things to say about that. One, that's not the true mindfulness
Not
because
at all.
you had an agenda, right?
Complete. I had a strong agenda.
Right. But the fact that you had that agenda was understandable given the way the teaching was framed. In my view, you would have to,
Yes.
it's very hard not to have that agenda. And that's a liability of that style of practice. And I think that liability is, there's a liability on the other side, on the Dzogchen side, which we can talk about, which we haven't talked about at all, really. But the liability of the goal-oriented momentum model of get as much mindfulness as you can on whatever you can notice is that there's a sense that you have to that freedom is elsewhere, that you're trying to get you schlep up to the top of the mountain and you are at the bottom. Yeah, and all you can notice is the fact that you are somewhere near the bottom of the mountain.
Yeah,
And
but
you have to keep working on this project. The difference between that and being able to just cut through to selflessness and really drop any obvious effort. I mean, that's the thing. You can be, the question is, when does it become effortless? Does it have to become effortless by virtue of momentum and all the practice takes on its a life of its own and you're just noticing effortlessly? Or can you notice that every true instant of awareness is, I mean, this is why in Dzogchen they talk about practicing the goal as the path. In my experience, that's not false advertising because even if you're going to only get a second of mindfulness in every hour, there's a difference between that second obviously being the goal, or that second being a strategy to reach some goal that is on the other side of this body of twisted iron.
I really don't see.
The importance of that
No, no.
distinction.
I, as you say, each tradition has, I see, its own strengths and its own potential pitfalls, and each tradition, it becomes obvious when one has practiced and fallen into the pitfalls, what they are. In the Vipassana practice, the danger is that, as I fell into, really practicing with an agenda, I think that's at that point I was not getting proper guidance. But I think when I finally came to an acceptance of just what was happening,
But it's a little subtler than that, and a little more insidious because what is proper guidance when the view is you really do need to get to the top of the mountain. So you're not at the top of the mountain right now, so you haven't had the cessation
But
experience.
that's no different than saying you need to get to stability.
But it is different because in each moment in which, so in this moment, I could say, how do you know you're not stable,
No,
right?
but
And for that moment, the moment of mindfulness is going to precipitate could be a moment of freedom, but it's not the same thing as cessation. It's not the same thing because you know the lights are still on. You haven't gotten to, you have a goal. You have a goal.
No, but there's a difference between there's there's so many different aspects of this. This is why I make the conversation because I want to hit many different
This is what
points.
this is dharmic whack-a-mole.
First, just to kind of step back, kind of looking at the Dzogchen tradition, which obviously, I've practiced and has had a hugely beneficial. I've learned a lot from the practice and incorporated a lot into Vipassana. So I'm not at all kind
You're not
of
hostile to the intent.
not only not hostile, it's like I'm Mr. One Dharma.
Right.
But when you look at the great Dzogchen masters, they have done years of preliminary practices
Years of
and
retreat. Yeah.
supportive practices
Oh
and
yeah.
20 years in a cave.
Yeah.
So it's not that it's
No, no,
not
no, no. And I'm not suggesting
that.
that retreat is unnecessary. And so look, before we, before, to spare you some of the pain of having to spell that all out. One of the obvious pitfalls of emphasizing non-duality and emphasizing that there's nowhere to go and nothing to get to and there's no goal is that a person can be left with a sense that there's nothing to do and no reason to practice, and they're going to spend the rest of their lives just thinking about they're either going to spend the rest of their lives just living a very ordinary life, doing all the things they wanted to do anyway and clinging to all their pleasures and averting from all their pains, or they're going to develop a concept that just sort of believing that everything's perfect is enough. And that's obviously delusional. So, yes, on the Dzogchen side, you see people...
Attachment to emptiness.
Right. Attachment to the view of emptiness is barring the door to a real breakthrough into stabilizing this experience. And which takes a tremendous amount of, if not effort, seeming effort, because these people spend years on retreat doing nothing but meditate. So we agree that's... That's on the menu, even if you do recognize the nature, the empty nature of consciousness.
Right. Okay, going back to the Vipassana. Once from that point of purification of view, where one has really seen that the whole process is just this knowing an object arising, passing, it's all happening by itself. There is an effort to get to that point. From that point, even though one can be pulled out of it by, as I was with trying to get back my body of light, and I was just not practicing in a correct way. But from that point, if one is in alignment with what mindfulness actually means, then even though there's a goal, one has dropped back into the unfolding process. Right. There's not a sense of, oh, I'm not there yet.
Yeah.
You know, and struggle. Yeah. And that's always available.
Yeah. Well, no, but that's not always available, because I've been that person who cycled back and forth from retreat and back into life and back to retreat.
Well, it hasn't been stabilized then. I've experienced some of that, but also experienced times when that's just there. That's always there.
But it's always
accessible.
It's always there when you're not on retreat.
Yeah.
So that is synonymous with your mindfulness.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. And so, and that's a kind of stabilizing.
Right.
Which is similar to the stabilizing of the recognition. You know, it's just, one doesn't have to build up the momentum to get there again.
Right.
It's what's there.
How is that the case? Because then what you're describing is a level of concentration. So let's say you're not on retreat and you're only going to sit for a half hour today. Right. And you sit, you close your eyes, you start focusing on the breath.
Whatever, just sound, open awareness.
Open or awareness. If you are nowhere near as concentrated as you are in the best sitting of your longest retreat,
no, but
there's a difference between having the momentum of concentration and not. Momentum is a retreat-like phenomenon that was contingent upon being seriously concentrated.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is that at a certain point,
even in your daily life, off retreat,
yes,
your experiences of sitting is one of being concentrated.
Concentrated enough to
have that same character
And that, to me, that's kind of an interesting development. It has been in Vipassana, because that is a kind of stabilizing. You're no longer struggling to get any place.
Yes.
You're just there. And it's just unfolding. And that's really how it is, you know, now.
That's not surprising to me. I'm trying to get at what is surprising to me here. It's not because the momentum has something to do with many moments together. What you can experience at time X is, in some sense, conditioned by what you experienced at time X minus one or X minus two. You know, that's what momentum is. And if you have been lost in thought for 5 minutes, if such a delusional experience could ever happen to you, or you're asleep and dreaming and you wake up, the question is, what can these next 2 seconds be like? And there's a sense in Vipassana that for those next 2 seconds to really deliver the goods, to be really like the best 2 seconds on a retreat, something has to be unusual. You spend a lot of time in Vipassana noticing sensory phenomenon with increasing apparent depth and subtlety. Everything starts happening very fast at points, and things disappear, and things that were there or normally there in sort of coarse awareness are no longer there, the boundaries of your body or whatever. Things are different. Things are not truly ordinary. There can be a sense that ordinary mindfulness of just a truly ordinary sensation just noticed doesn't taste like
it
freedom.
Does.
Oh, okay, so it does. It does, but from the Dzogchen side, that's the point that has to be grasped
right.
in order to even feel like you can start. That's emphasized so much from the beginning that there is no depth. Freedom is right on the surface. There's no depth. There's no subtlety. The changes in the pyrotechnics of meditative change
but
don't mean anything.
But
but that has a psychological consequence. It's unthinkable to be the yogi who is trying to get back to the body of light in that sense. I mean, like to spend 2 years trying to, how could you do that from the Dzogchen side, having been given the Dzogchen logic of practice?
Right. No, that is a particular potential pitfall of the Vipassana map. But as you said, Dzogchen has its own potential pitfalls.
Right.
And they happen to be different.
Except within Dzogchen, they're not, those pitfalls are criticized enough that they're not really, I mean, the real pitfall is the sort of like Advaita Vedantic version of Dzogchen, whereas where you in the kind of the talking school of non-duality, where you're sitting with someone who's talking about non-duality and there's nothing to do really.
No, there are other pitfalls in Dzogchen beside the one. But I mean, I don't think this pitfall in Vipassana, I mean, I think, for example, if I had been practicing with Upandita, that would have been...
He would have gotten you past
I think really quickly. I mean, I had many examples of that.
Right.
Where he would just say...
But you must have had examples of practicing, striving in your practice under Upandita and getting into a very goal-oriented, effortful... and therefore painful attempt to get somewhere with the practice. Because I know what it's like to sit with Upandita, and that's coming out of his pores. I heard him say to someone in as you know, with practicing with Upandita, you could hear the interviews with other yogis, you know, the interview before you and the interview after you as you were creeping out of the room. And some of the stuff he would say, he was a drill sergeant.
Yeah, but also, it's very hard to, because
I can't remember now whether it was you, it's your story, or whether I overheard this with another yogi. But he said, "It's a pity you don't have more courage." was that you, or was that
No, he said something like, "Don't you have any pride in being a man?" But one of the interesting things that I came to appreciate about him was, and I saw this over time, it wasn't immediately apparent, that he would often be saying these kind of outrageous things, and he would keep doing it until there was no longer a reaction in my mind. And as soon as I got to a place of lightness...
That's very Zen of him.
It was. Yeah, I mean, and I saw that, and there were a few very striking examples. As soon as I stopped reacting to his trying to push my buttons, he stopped doing it. Yeah. And actually, the whole relationship and style of his teaching changed. So in some way, and I'm not to say he never kind of emphasized the striving and all that, but... It's not to take everything on face value when you see the approach of different people, because sometimes they're doing things as a skillful means to get people to unhook. And that was just...
My experience with him was the opposite. I knew his reputation, and I heard how he was dealing with other people, and I was I was practicing in a very effortful mode.